Good morning. I like before starting, I would like to thank Lecal actually, and notably Lucille Duchamp and Nadia Dalla Libera, who have taken care of my visit today. And I would like especially to thank Vincent Normand and Tristan Garcia for having invited me here. I have to say I'm very honored to have been invited to participate to this very ambitious research project, and also like to give the last talk after many people who have I admire the work, and I'm also happy to meet you and to looking forward to discuss your work this afternoon. So I've entitled my talk Blank Space about the White Cube and the Generic Space of Contemporary Art. In the background lies a question, in fact, which is basically what is contemporary art? My talk this morning doesn't aim at answering this question, or at least it doesn't aim to give a definition, a conclusive definition. What I would like to do is try to understand how this question has historically framed what we call contemporary art, the particular site it is. So by blank space, I'm here pointing to the fact that we've taken the habit of considering both the contemporary gallery space and museum space as a neutral space. A space extracted from the many stratification and hierarchies that structure the social space as a whole. For some, this neutrality is often often translates a kind of elitist construction. For others, it can be more something of a possibility, like the neutrality of the space of contemporary art being kind of neutral bottom line from which almost anything can happen. What I would like to show you is that I think this neutrality is actually far from being given, that it has been historically constructed, and that by doing so, I'll show that it's neither, in fact, just a social, the space of a social privilege, neither just a space of possibility or endless possibility. So to put it in a nutshell, I think the neutrality that we talk about when we talk about this space may be actually more paradoxical than it seems. So I'll proceed in different steps, like five steps. Firstly, I would like to talk about a recent exhibition in the National Gallery of Modern Art in Rome to show you a little bit how the contemporary is even now somehow inside or invest the modern museum. Secondly, I look quickly at contemporary debates on contemporary art, understanding it as a pure present. And then I'll show first a genealogy of that condition from art practices before making the move that I think is more of the singularity of the talk I'm going to give today, which is in fact based on an architectural reading of this space, before concluding with probably like a few remarks on what that on what this can mean for art practices today. So, what is contemporary art? I think the best way to delve in this problem is actually to take it as a spatial question, is to understand that when we see an exhibition, or when we enter what is called contemporary art, we first enter a particular space. So here is a view of this National Gallery of Modern Art, the entrance in Rome, and the entrance to an exhibition called At the Moment Time is Out of Joint. And what I think was striking for me when I saw this exhibition was to see how actually it was presented as a very contemporary display, arguing that it was in fact displaying artworks in a neutral space, regardless of their periodization or their historical framing. So actually quoting the press release, there is this this online cultural guide in which the journalist writes, by positioning these works out of their ordinary and expected places, the curators push the viewers to approach each artwork from an individualistic point of view. Instead of observing these pieces because they are a part of a certain art historicism, viewers' attitudes towards the artworks take a more exclusive form. With or without having a background in art, this new face of La Galleria shows a different side of both the existing collection and new works. And I think here you have a lot of things which actually I think are characteristic of this contemporary space of art. Here are a few pictures of this exhibition. You can see, of course, the fountain of Duchamp, which I'm going to talk about later on. And you can see it's this sort of very common form of display, but in which, in fact, you can recognize probably a few pieces here, but in which you have this kind of neutralization, once again, the fact that that this space is, in fact, organizing time, historical time, in a sort of pure co-presence, in a sort of juxtapositions, in which actually the artworks are only ordered according to themes, colors, things that actually would not mean much for an art historian or for the historiography of art, but which is supposed to bring a new sort of relation to those works as individual pieces and individual pieces only. Here again, you have an exemplar of this way of working with, like, everything is put on the same table. So this was, like, this exhibition. And I think, like, I would like also to quote another way in which this exhibition was presented, which says, the National Gallery of Modern Art underwent a recent facelift, challenging gallery conventions. From their logo update to their early 1900-influenced Wi-Fi lounge, to the uncrafted bookstore, the 6-month-long probe into the spatial redesign was celebrated in June and welcomes its inaugurating exhibit, Time is Out of Joint. The title, derived from Shakespeare's Hamlet, alludes to the elasticity of the concept of time, a time that is not linear but stratified. And here I think the paradox is, in fact, that claiming to neutralize this linearity of time, what we see is actually a completely leveling of time, which actually says we have to deal with a stratified conception of time, but saying that at the same time as it actually removes the tools that we generally have to understand this stratification, which is history itself. So it says space is stratified, but at the same time, it deprives the spectators of any tools to actually understand this stratification. And I think what is interesting for me here is the fact that, I mean, what you have in this exhibition is that you start to see the space, in fact, rather than the artworks. You start to wonder what is this space that actually organizes this leveling of time. And this, I think, is connected to recent debates or questions that have been asked by many people. I'm here thinking about the editors of Iflux, but also about the work of Suhail Malik, for instance, as well as the work of Peter Osborne and Juliano Rebentich, who have been talking before me here. And I'm here particularly referring to this double issue put forward by Iflux in 2009, which was entitled, What is Contemporary Art? And the interesting story here is that actually they launched this double issue in response to the will they had to construct a sort of wiki of contemporary art. And like starting to think about how they would construct this wiki, they of course started to think about how can you build like a basic navigation tools to actually navigate this wiki. And doing that, they started to wonder and to not actually find any grip. They were asking, okay, should we organize things by movement? But in fact, they have not been like relevant or particularly silent movements in the last two decades. Should we organize that by medium? But contemporary artists are working across a variety of mediums. Should we organize that by geographic location, which they discarded as being something that the CIA would do more than actually editors of a contemporary art magazine? And so in the end, they say, in the end, we found that no objective structure or criterion exists with which to organize artistic activity from the past 20 years or so. And the question of how to structure such an archive to make it intelligible proved to be so difficult to address that it completely derailed the project for the time being. And so what you have here is precisely, I think, what the title of the exhibition means, is time is out of joint. What it means in a way is that the contemporary is supposed to be this neutral space, precisely, that organizes this pure co-presence, without actually providing any tools to navigate this neutral space. And so I think in order to understand that, or to actually go beyond this puzzlement or this dead end that the editors of Iflux encountered, one has to look at history. One has to try to do the genealogy of this neutral space. So first, I would like to start with hard practices. Contemporary art is a field that has been structured, of course, first of all, by specific art practices. And I'll do that in three steps. The first one concerns the ready-made. The second one concerns the completion and reversal of this gesture by conceptual artists in the 60s and 70s. And the third one will concern the institutional critique and the way it paradoxically continued to expand this gesture. So first, the ready-made. The ready-made is first an operator that works against the canonical forms and rules of representation according to which one could previously speak about a work of art. So even when subversive of the canon, if you think, for instance, about impressionism, the question remains before about mastering a specific mode of painting. So you replaced a certain set of rules by another. But what the ready-made does is actually not just to replacing this set of rules by another, but actually to negate this canonical system of rules altogether. So the ready-made, as people like Jeff Wall or Thierry de Duve have argued, is first a negative gesture, a negation of the criteria according to which not only artworks, but in fact art as such, can be valued. From this standpoint, it can be said that contemporary art emerged precisely from the ready-made. That is, together with the questioning of what art is and can be about. So you have this opening of the question of what is art, which I think constitutes precisely the mark between contemporary art and what was before. Yet it also seems that the idea of pure co-presence I was talking about before, and the contemporary as this kind of neutral space in which time has no linearity and actually no stratification either, is not entirely attributable to Duchamp's ready-made. I think to really understand that, you have to look at the way in which conceptual artists in the 60s and the 70s have actually expanded and reversed this gesture. So here is a wall painting of Saul Lewitt. And I think here I would like to talk briefly about what Jeff Wall calls the conceptual reduction. The conceptual reduction starts, in fact, with minimalism, and notably with Donald Judd, and what he called specific objects. What is important in what Jeff Wall says about those specific objects is that, in fact, they were not specific in the sense we could first think about. They were specific in the sense that they were actually generic models. They were generic models of what an artwork could be about. So the generic models, in a way, if you replace specific objects by generic models, do not only underline the way industrial objects are produced, rather than being patented standards that can be reproduced, they are somehow, in their minimalist reduction, in different models, pointing to at once this industrial logic and questioning the concept of art as such. So while Duchamp questioned art by introducing ordinary objects in a gallery, Judd pursued this gesture further by attempting to formalize the indifference that Duchamp claimed was at the art of determining the way he chose those ordinary objects as precisely the subject of the work. And I think in relation to that, conceptual artists like Saul Lewitt went even a step further. By replacing the art object by a text or the simple claim of the reasons why this object could not be deprived of the status of a work of art, they completely disembodied the artwork, which became instead a pure idea or a pure sign. In doing so, the conceptual reduction at once accomplishes and reverses the negative logic that animated the ready-made. It translates this negation into a principle of positive inclusion. Anything can be art. Yet, to say that anything can be art also implies that ultimately everything risk to be evaluated according to this only criterion. Meaning, anything that you could put in the gallery would be ultimately only valued as a work of art. So instead of negating art and expanding its boundaries or the boundaries of the gallery, what you're doing is that you are expanding the boundaries of the gallery instead of expanding what art can be about. So you're expanding the definition of art rather than expanding what art can do or be about. So here I'm referring to a particular work of Andrea Fraser, which is called May I Help You, which was a performance she did in 1991. Which I think extended, actually, what started to be done by conceptual artists, but in a sort of ironic and melancholic way. So Fraser stood in a gallery in which a series of minimalist paintings by Alan McCollum was exhibited, and ironically extrapolated or caricatured the sort of vain discourse of cultural and commercial valorization that one can often hear in a gallery space. What I find particularly symptomatic here is that, of course, this gesture was meant as a critique of the logic of the gallery, yet it also transformed this critique into a work of art. So here you have precisely an illustration of this paradoxical way in which the more you try to be, more real to produce an art that would be more authentic, that would actually challenges this space of the gallery, the more actually you extend the realm of the gallery. Because precisely these critical gestures, after all, becomes nothing else than a work of art as such. So again, you expand the realm of the definition of the artwork instead of expanding the potentiality that it could be about something else, having a more critical political traction on any situation, having etc. And this, I think, is precisely the paradoxical problem that contemporary art faces. The more, again, artists claim to be critical and reflexive, the more they claim to escape or to negate the logic that supports what is considered to be vain in contemporary art, the more they want to be authentic, the more they reaffirm a logic that, since the conceptual reduction at least, is actually only extending the realms of the special space that this gesture has constructed in the 60s and the 70s. And I think actually this is the paradox of what Rosalind Krauss called the extended field of contemporary art. And what I would like to do is, in order to better understand this paradox and to understand what we can do, how we can engage with it in a more lucid way, I think might be useful to do what I would call an architectural genealogy of the white cube, which is understanding really what this space is as a space. So taking literally the fact that we talk about a particular space of art. And to do so, I refer first to this canonical book or series of texts by Brian O'Doherty, which was published in 1999, but which was actually a collection of texts that were written in 76. So in the context of the conceptual reduction. And which actually has framed or even coined the term white cube. It's in this text that you find really the term. And so interestingly, the genealogy that Doherty does in his book starts with another and actually less known Duchamp, which is not the Duchamp of the ready-made, but which is the Duchamp of the gallery gestures that he made in the 30s and 40s in New York. You have here a photograph of an installation which is called The Mile of String, which is from 1942, and which was actually the answer of Duchamp to an invitation that was made by the gallery to actually curate the work of his fellow surrealist. And he replied precisely by filling this space with this mile of string. That is, by, in a way, trolling this exhibition. But at the same time, I think, revealing precisely what was starting to be this particular space in which those works could be assembled, could be juxtaposed. And at the same time, revealing to the spectator the particular void in which he was invited to enter. So Doherty writes about this exhibition: the spectator is erased, every bit of space is marked. Duchamp develops the modernist monad, the spectator in his gallery box. And in a way, I think that from that you can rethink a little bit what the conceptual reduction has been about. If you take a few works that Doherty refers to in his book, here you have The West Wall by William Anastasi in 1967, which was actually a painting that reproduced literally the wall of the gallery in which it was exhibited. You have then another work by Gene Davis, which was only actually presenting the gallery space as it was, that is, with nothing in it, 1968, still in New York. And you have then also less Levine, white side, which basically constituted the same kind of gesture, that is exhibiting the space as such, with changing a few things about the light, but that's it. So these three installations are those that are explicitly mentioned and integrated in Doherty's book. But you could also think more generally about many works from Sol Lewitt, first wall and floor structures in 1962, Dan Flavin, fluorescent light sculptures in 1963, like starting in 1963, Donald Judd wall stacks, 1966, Carl André floor grids, etc., etc. That is, to site-specific works, site was first and foremost the gallery space, this specific space that the gallery started to materialize. Here is a work of Sol Lewitt from 1970, which I think also interestingly underlines the sort of genealogy that Doherty draws by referring to this mile of string of Duchamp, which is also actually a painting that draws lines from the plugs which are in the wall of the gallery. And so, in a way, O'Doherty's book invites us to understanding the reversal and finalization of the logic in which modernism engaged contemporary art from the ready-made and beyond to the conceptual reduction and then the institutional critique as the revelation of the very specific context that the white cube represents, materializes, and formalizes. Because in fact, the subtitle of Doherty's book is The Ideology of the Gallery Space. So it's an ideological critique, but which I think interestingly focuses on what are, at the end, spatial structures. So it doesn't focuses on discourses by curators or things like that. It really focuses on this space. And I think that's why it's actually possible to do this architectural reading of the white cube that I'm about to do. So consider this very generic photograph of a white cube, or generic photograph of a generic white cube. And consider also maybe the exhibition that I showed you at first. And here is what O'Doherty wrote in 1976. He wrote, "We have now reached a point where we see not the art, but the space first. An image comes to mind of a white, ideal space that, more than any single picture, may be the archetypal image of 20th century art. It clarifies itself through a process of historical inevitability usually attached to the art it contains." Another quote from Doherty is, "A gallery is constructed along laws as rigorous as those for building a medieval church. The outside world must not come in, so windows are usually sealed off. Walls are painted white. The ceiling becomes the source of light. The wooden floor is polished so that you can click along clinically, or carpeted so that you can pad soundlessly, resting the feet while the eyes have the wall. The art is free, as the saying used to go, to take on its own life. The discrete desk may be the only piece of furniture. In this context, a standing ashtray becomes almost a sacred object, just as the fire hose in a modern museum looks not like a fire hose, but an aesthetic conundrum. Modernism's transposition of perception from life to formal values is complete, and this is, of course, one of modernism's fatal diseases. End of quote. So from that, what I think is that actually you can see the white cube as the spatial institutionalization of the gesture of the conceptual reduction. That is, it is the space where, while the conceptual reduction was replacing a work of art by a discourse about why this object should be considered an artwork, you have here a space that doesn't even need to say anything. It sanctifies everything that you put in it as part of this space that we call contemporary art. So it sanctifies anything that you put in it as an artwork. My hypothesis is that, in fact, the white cube can be seen as the mirror image or the negative photograph of Le Corbusier's Maison Dom-ino. And as such, the institutionalization of the ready-made as the generic condition of contemporary art. So let me explain that. Le Corbusier's Maison Dom-ino is a prototype from 1914. At the time, it was mainly conceived as a principle for the construction of houses in series, for the industrialization of architecture, notably in front of the need that was already envisioned for constructing rapidly houses that were destroyed by World War I in the north of France. Yes, yet if this was at first very contextual, this prototype has also been considered as one of the hallmarks of modern architecture. For many years, the dominant interpretation remained that of a prototype that expressed the modern aspiration to conceive an industrial architecture, both stylistically and functionally. This was notably advocated by Colin Rowe, who saw in it the continuation of the geometrical and rational project that animated architecture since the Renaissance. But in a famous text that Peter Eisenman wrote in 1979, so here again we move back to the moment of the conceptual reduction, he claimed that actually the Maison Dom-ino materialized a much more profound change. For Eisenman, the reception of Le Corbusier had generally obscured the one aspect of Le Corbusier's work that makes it truly modernist. That is, and I quote, his aspect as a self-referential sign, its existence as an architecture about architecture. So, much like the ready-made did in art talk about art as such, or represented this negative gesture that allowed to talk about art as such, Maison Dom-ino for Eisenman does the same for architecture. It speaks about architecture as such. It gives the sort of minimal conditions from which you can talk about any sort of any kind of architecture. And I think it's particularly interesting here to see that the same way the conceptual reduction for artists in the 70s transformed the negative gesture of Duchamp into a positive principle of inclusion. Again, anything can be art. In fact, the Maison Dom-ino already did that in its first gesture. Its first gesture is not so much a negation of previous orders or stylistic organization of architecture, but the affirmation, a positive affirmation of what architecture can be about, in a very general and hence, I would say, generic sense. One of the most striking aspects of this self-referentiality for Eisenman is the fact, and I quote, that man is no longer required to walk around the building to understand the object. And here again, I think there is a very striking parallel with the ready-made, in the sense that the fountain, as I showed you, was first published as an image in a journal, that was explaining or showing the reasons why it was refused by the curators of the exhibition it was supposed to enter. So in both cases, what you have is that you have, in fact, not only a model, a generic model, but you have a generic sign. You have this sort of hors-sol sign, ungrounded sign. So in fact, I think Maison Dom-ino is as much a prototype as a conceptual model. It is an idea, something that you actually can understand without having to experience it as architecture is generally experienced, which is as walking through, inhabiting the space. And basically, what you have is you have columns, you have three slabs, one staircase, and that's it. I'm not entering the details of how this is actually designed and drawn, which actually it's important to understand itself, referentiality, but I don't have time. But I think it's enough in a way to understand this this sort of minimalist reduction of architecture. So here in this case it is, and as Eisenman text shows, which it's a text in which he redraws the Maison Dom-ino step by step, what you have is the structure itself that is made explicit. So architecture stripped bare of all particularities, architecture in the most minimal but also the most general sense. And this is actually a very big change. I mean, as big as the ready-made was for art, in the sense that it puts an end to centuries of reflection on specific orders defined by specific stylistic and constructive details. It also puts an end to the typological reflection that had driven early modernity, notably in the work of Quatremer de Quincy, Jean-Louis-Nicolas Durand, or Louis-Étienne Boulet. Maison Dom-ino points to the most primitive condition of architecture, its profound speciality by opposition to simply geometry plus use and meaning. In this sense, Peter Eisenman writes, the Maison Dom-ino is a sign system which refers to this most primitive condition of architecture, which distinguishes it from geometry or from geometry plus use and meaning. But more importantly, in this context, the Maison Dom-ino can be seen to reflect a modernist or self-referential condition of sign, and thus a true and seminal break from the 400 years old tradition of Western humanist culture. And I think it's exactly what the ready-made understood and institutionalized as a positive gesture by conceptual artists did for art at the very moment when the white cube became the generic space of art, meaning like the space in which contemporary art is usually exhibited and always exhibited. So as I said before, the white cube is the mirror image or the photographic negative of the Maison Dom-ino. And as much as Maison Dom-ino acts as a self-referential sign in architecture, the white cube reverses Duchamp's negative ready-made gesture into a positive and generic self-referential sign. So the statement materialized in the white cube is less that art can be anything, but that anything can be art. And I think basically what is the main problem with that, in a way? The main problem, I think, is the principle of absolute equivalence that the white cube organizes. Any white cube equals any other white cube, at least in the sense that it's a pure manifestation of Euclidean space, literally a cube painted in white. Here we can probably better understand why the editors of Iflux struggled so much to find criteria according to which they could operate a navigation tool in the landscape of contemporary art. Because there, nothing really differs, things only vary. So in the Y cube, everything might look different. Everything might look an individual object that you can immediately perceive or encounter. But I would argue that through this genealogy I did, that from a logical, political, and economical point of view, everything is ultimately the same. And in fact, the separation that the white cube organizes in this way from the rest of society may not be that different from the act of decontextualization that presided over the establishment of the first modern museum, namely the Louvre. Here is a photograph by Candida Hofer from 2005. Of course, here I'm also playing with the structural similarities between two pictures, but I think that beyond that, you actually see probably what we should probably do work on that, a much more structural similarity between the white cube and the space of the modern museum. As Doherty said, unshadowed, white, clean, artificial, the space is devoted to the technology of aesthetics. Works of art are mounted, hung, scattered for study. Their ungrubbly surfaces are untouched by time and its vicissitudes. Here again, you find this idea of the stratification of time that is actually deprived of any tools to actually engage with it, and which becomes this pure presence, this surface, in a way. Doherty continues, art exists in a kind of eternity of display, and though there is lots of period, we should say today postmodern, there is no time. This eternity gives the gallery a limbo-like status, one has to have died already to be there. So to conclude briefly, what might be done? Well, I think you may have already guessed that what I think is that first is the implicit logic at play in the white cube that must be confronted for what it is, meaning that should be made explicit in order to actually be lucid about this logic of equivalence that it repeats and organizes. And why that? Because I think that it's the only way in which you can actually really engage with the other side of the white cube, which is, on the one end, this principle of absolute equivalence that is a problem, but on the other end, a principle of absolute polyvalence that could actually be engaged as a positive condition for experimentation, for things that you can actually probably not do in other spaces. So the genealogy I presented here charts a totally different history than that which we are generally told. The period is usually distinguished between three successive phases. The modern phases, that is usually seen to have started with the Enlightenment, notably Diderot and the Salon. Then the modernist phase, when the avant-garde invent the autonomy of art, engage in medium purification and in the negation of the canonical forms of representation. And then a postmodern phase, which starting in the 70s, would have represented the neutralization of both modern and modernist hierarchies, neutralizing its exclusive and progressist telos into one potentially infinite space of inclusion where everything is deemed possible. And I think that once you understand what happened to contemporary art in the 70s through the conceptual reduction on the one hand and the institutionalization through that in the white cube of the ready-made, you can actually understand that a much more modern continuum, in fact, is still driving this whole idea of neutralization. So I think this neutralization is not at all a liquidation of the division that have supported the existence of the modern museum until the contemporary space of the white cube, but is actually still very operative. And I think that's why we need to confront it, because otherwise you risk to misinterpret actually this neutralization for liquidation. And in fact, the only liquidation that this neutralization does is the liquidation of all tools to actually engage with this history and to engage with art practices that could be about something else than art itself, and about something else than the endless extension of the valuation of an artwork to any sort of dynamic. Think, for instance, of the invitation of Occupy in the last documenta, which is a problem if you don't understand what is this specific space in which you invite them, that is, as a space of exhibition, with all the rules that I've been trying to make explicit this morning. If you don't do that, you just invite them to totally neutralize what it should be, which is occupying a museum. It doesn't work in the same way that occupying a public space works. And I think this is a very important thing. So to end on that, I think that the way in which Brian O'Doherty described the art of the 70s or the space of art in the 70s is actually very much the space in which we are. He said, with postmodernism, the gallery space is no longer neutral. The wall becomes a membrane through which aesthetic and commercial values osmotically exchange. As this molecular shudder in the white walls becomes perceptible, there is a further inversion of context. The walls assimilate and the art discharges, which means also politically discharges. How much can the art do without? This calibrates the degree of the gallery's mystification. How much of the object's eliminated content can the white wall replace? Context provides a large part of late modern and postmodern art's content. And Doherty concluded at the time, this is 70s art's main issue, as well as its strength and weakness. And I think from what I've tried to show you, that we can actually, that this is also very much contemporary art as a wall's main issue, as well as its strength and weakness. Thank you.